First Corinthians chapter 3. Still looking at this subject. Not a little bit, whatever it is. Solid frustrations. And as we look at Paul, I believe Paul was really dealing with some issues and some things that caused him to be frustrated. The letter he wrote to the church at Corinth, it's important that we understand that Corinth was one of the, what Paul believed, one of the stronger congregations that he helped to establish, that he helped to plant. So when word got to Paul about some of the things that were going on at the church of Corinth, it was really disappointing to him. You ever taken someone under your wings and you tried to invest time in teaching and nurturing and nourishing and encouraging and exhorting and edifying, and then you find out that they're not where you thought they were. You found out that they're not where they could be. You find out that they're not where they should be, from a spiritual sense. And I'm of a mind, call me simple or whatever, I'm of a mind that if we get the spiritual right, all this other junk that we deal with every day, we can handle it. We can deal with all this other stuff once we get the spiritual right. But if we don't get the spiritual right, everything that comes our way is going to be a crisis. It's going to be a catastrophe. It's going to be disastrous. It's going to cause us fear and anxiety and all other things that we deal with. But if we get the spiritual right, no matter what comes to us or comes our way, we will be prepared to deal with it. Amen. So Paul, as he addressed the church at Corinth, it was his belief that this was one of the stronger congregations that he had helped to establish. But then things started to come to him. And Paul, being who he is, a man who loves the Lord and fears the Lord and keeps his commandments, he set out to do something to help the church at Corinth. So he writes this letter. And we looked at the first Corinthians chapter 1 and the first Corinthians chapter 2, and we looked at the things he addressed, and now we are at 1 Corinthians, the third chapter, to continue to look at the things that Paul addressed with the church at Corinth. And the overall theme, as you go through the first letter to the church at Corinth, you can see that Paul was addressing their stagnation. They had not developed to where they should have been, or where he thought they could have been at that particular time, and it was concerning to Paul. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning at verse number 1, it says, "And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ." He says, "I have fed you with milk and not with meat. For hitherto or up until this time you were not able to bear it, neither yet now are you able." He says, "For you are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envy and strife and divisions, are you not carnal and walk as men walk? For while one saith, I am of Paul, and another, I am Apollos, are you not carnal? Who then," he asked, "is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom you believe, even as the Lord gave to every man?" He says, "I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So that neither is he that planted anything, neither he that watered, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. According to the grace of God which is given unto me, Paul said, as a wise master builder. You see, Paul fell and built that congregation. He says, I have laid the foundation and another build a third one. But let every man take heed how he build thereupon. He says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Yeah. Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. All Christians, no matter who you may be, at some point you are going to deal with this adversary, this dangerous, powerful adversary called frustration or disappointment. What do we do? Where do we turn? How do we overcome him? How do we as Christians defeat this silent beast? How do we deal with an enemy that many of us never even hear approaching? We looked at many individuals and how they deal with frustration. This frustration simply means to disappoint. Have you ever want to go with me, somebody? Have you ever wanted to go out in the middle of a field? Make sure you got permission paper first, amen. And just at the top of your lungs, scream because of frustration, annoyance, anger, vexation, irritation. Have you just ever felt like screaming because of disappointment in your life? All of us have been there at some point. Even Paul, this man of God, this apostle of Jesus Christ, as one born out of due season, even Paul, with the power and the knowledge that he had, having had firsthand experience of talking to the Lord, even Paul dealt with being frustrated. So this letter that Paul wrote to the church at Corinth, it dealt with a lot of diverse issues. It deal with issue upon issue upon issue. But I believe that the overall intent of the letter to Corinth was to encourage them. You see, Paul wasn't just, as we would say, fussing, amen, for the sake of fussing. Some people fuss, amen, just for the sake of hearing themselves fuss. But Paul here was bringing things to their attention because he had a genuine concern about where they were spiritually. Paul understood that they were not where they could have been, were not where they should have been, and they were not where he believed they ought to have been. And here's the thing Paul was concerned about. Because you are not developed spiritually like you should have, you are taking a chance on forfeiting your claim on heaven. Everybody talks about heaven. Everybody wants to go to heaven according to them. But then everybody don't want to live, amen. The way we have to live in order to go to heaven. So in chapter 1, real briefly, the church problem that Paul was dealing with, they were not where they needed to be spiritually. They were immature. This church, Paul starts out to help them to understand that they were mentally divided. They were mentally divided based on their speech, their mindset, their judgment, their allegiances. One following this person, one following that person, one following this person. All kind of division and strife and things going on. And Paul said, this ain't the way it should be. Amen. And he says, while you are still immature, you cannot grasp on to the fact that it's not about Paul. It's not about Apollos, it's not about Silas, it's not about Cephas, it is about the Lord. Amen. I understand. Sometimes we grasp on to someone or something. But at the end of the day, the only thing that really matters is, did you fear God and keep His commandments?
Amen.
All this other stuff's not going to mean anything in the end.
Amen.
And that's what Paul is telling them in chapter 1, part 1 we looked at. He also talked to them. He said, while you are still mature, you can't grasp onto the fact that it's all about Christ. And another thing he says, you can't figure God out.
Amen.
You try to take the wisdom that's of this world and try to apply that towards the wisdom of God, and you can't figure God out.
Mm-mm.
God is who He is. His way is in the steep. His paths are in the sea. If somebody wants to walk across the water, you can't tell which way they went. He said, that's what it's like trying to figure out God. Amen. It's not our job, amen, to figure out God. It's our responsibility to obey God. God doesn't ask us to do anything crazy. God doesn't ask us to do anything that's grievous. Amen. God does not ask us to do anything unreasonable. God doesn't ask us to strap a bomb on our body and go blow up people. Amen.
Amen.
So our job is to obey God and do what He said to do. He's not asking us to do anything. Amen. Far-fetched. So then in chapter 2, Paul is, he's still concerned about the maturity level of the church. So he focuses on the way he came to them. He said, I came to you in a spirit of humility, a spirit of concern for the church at Corinth. He said, I want you to focus on these spiritual things pertaining to God. And through your growth and your maturity, those are things I want you to deal with. And when you grow spiritually, and when you mature spiritually, you are prepared to handle whatever comes your way. You ever see some people in the church that no matter what happens, they still maintain their composure?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, what does it take to shake this person? Well, before you can shake them, you got to be able to shake their faith.
Mm-hmm.
And their faith is what is holding them and helping them to hold their own. You have to have a strong faith.
Amen.
And believe in God that no matter what's going on, it's going to be okay. All things work to the good for them who love the Lord and they're called according to His purpose. I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. That's what that person is living by. I walk by faith, not by sight. If I look at all the things that are going around me, I look at the people I'm dealing with, I'm not going to. Without the Lord, I'm not going to make it. So Paul says you got to keep your focus on the Lord. Focus on spiritual things, and you'll be prepared to handle anything that comes your way. Unfortunately, as I spoke about last week, I don't want to get to my lesson, thank you. The church today, while we are in an immature state in our spiritual life, without even being conscious of what we are doing, we have a tendency to walk like the world, to talk like the world, to look like the world, to stand in defense of worldly standards and principles, and then we wonder why we have such a difficult time over and over and over, and we're never really able to overcome the world. It's because we are so much a part of. It's hard to overcome something when you're so much a part of it. While we are immature, while we have that right foot in the world and that left foot in the church, we cannot grow or mature to where we need to be spiritual. And here's the thing that I left with on that particular part. You can't take this worldly life with you. You can't take all this worldly stuff with you. So why do we devote so much time in pursuit of and trying to fulfill the lust of the world? You can't take it with us. None of this stuff will be allowed into heaven. Mentally or physically, it won't be allowed in there. So why do we spend so much time being tangled up in the things and the cares and concerns of the world. We have to grow. We have to be spiritually. We have to mature spiritually.
Things, huh?
And then in chapter 3,
that's the truth.
A couple of things and we're down here. You heard the text in chapter 3. And here's the thing I want you to hold on to. Understand that God provides the increase.
Amen.
If you're looking for increase from anywhere else outside of God, you're going to be disappointed.
Amen.
You're going to be frustrated. Amen. If you're looking for increase from anywhere outside and separate from the Lord, you are going to be highly disappointed.
Amen.
God provides the increase.
Amen.
The problem that Paul, and y'all know I'm not talking about nation, but I'm talking about the church of Corinth, y'all. I'm talking about the church, amen. Are you part of the church?
Amen.
Paul addressed this letter to the church of Corinth, and I'm addressing this letter to the church at J Street. Because some of the things that Paul dealt with the church of Corinth, some of those same things can be seen sometimes. Sometimes we can see those same things in ourselves.
Amen.
Notice I said ourselves. We talk about y'all and stuff, amen.
Amen.
I talk about us.
Amen.
Because when I'm preaching to you, I'm preaching to myself. When I preach to you, thou shalt not steal. I can't say, well, thou shalt not, but I sure can.
Amen.
That's not the way it works as a gospel preacher, amen.
Amen.
So when I preach to the congregation, I'm preaching to myself. We have to understand that God provides for increase. And here's the thing. Paul looked at the church at Corinth, and Paul said, you are not grown. How many of you just changed channels on me? You can't tell me I'm 100 years old. You can't tell me I'm not grown. If you got the attitude, they just move up on me. We are not wrong, Paul says to the church. Paul says, you are underdeveloped. Talk about the church. As the spiritual element in Christians is developed, only under the instruction of the Holy Spirit, the flesh loses the rule that it has. You should, Brother Bishop said a mouthful. Can you please say that again? As the spiritual element in a Christian develops, y'all got that part?
Uh-huh.
As the spiritual element in a Christian develops, the fleshly part, the carnal part, loses its power.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
As I develop spiritually, the flesh, and all elements I develop under the instruction of the Holy Spirit, the flesh loses its rule.
Uh-huh.
It loses its power. That flesh that says, I'm going to go after this,
uh-huh,
is overruled by that spirit that says, oh, no, you aren't.
Amen.
Ain't. I meant to say ain't. The aren't going to sound right. I know ain't going to sound right either, but ain't sound better. Amen. As I grow spiritually, as the spiritual element of me grows and develops, under the instruction, not going to stay there the rest of the day, y'all.
Amen.
Under the instruction of the Holy Spirit, the flesh loses its rule. As the spiritual element grows, the flesh is a trade-off.
Mm-hmm.
I said, Brother Bishop, I still dealt with the same thing I was dealing with 40 years ago. You ain't grown. You haven't grown. Brother Bishop, I'm still dealing with lust of the flesh. Yeah, since you ain't grown. Because as the spiritual element, under the instruction, notice, so that means you got to listen to somebody, huh? You got to listen to God's word, amen. The Holy Spirit guides us, amen, through the word, tells us how not to live. So as we live and grow this way, then this, it loses its rule.
Amen.
That's what we're dealing with. growing spiritually. We're not allowing enough spiritual to affect us. We're putting up defense, man. We're like Wonder Woman, man. Why? No. Well, Bishop's going teaching that you, Sunday school teacher's going teaching that you Wednesday night, Tuesday, and the Bible sitting on the table home being dust and stuff. We fight it off. But the flesh, it loses its rule. And because the flesh does not lose its rule, as the spirit develops, we are not growing, or we're growing slower than we could be otherwise. And I'm not saying you're going to get it all overnight. Like Paul and those guys, they had a miraculous form of knowledge, amen? Paul got to be where he got to be initially because everything was done in a miraculous way, but then there came a time where Paul, amen? Paul had to study too, amen? Paul had to practice too. He had to practice patience. He had to practice forgiveness. He had to practice love. Not the people around trying to hurt Paul. Paul had to learn how to love those people. But as we go spiritually, the rule that the flesh has on us or over us, it diminishes. And here's another thing Paul addresses them. And I'm just simply going through the text that I read to you earlier. Paul addressed to them the fact that we fail to improve ourselves so that when we ought to be skilled in the word, eat meat and grow strong, be able to bear heavy burdens and help others, we ourselves, Paul says to the church at Corinth, are weak babies. Mm-hmm. Now imagine we have this fellowship today, and we go in there and everybody get in line and get ready to grow. And all things are going to take a bunch of bottles of milk. Apples, somebody here, you go to KFC or something. They drink this size of milk. We think something's wrong with that, wouldn't we? Why? Because milk is okay, it has its proper place, but man, I need some meat. When I eat, I want to eat. I want to eat grown folk food, amen. Remember when you was a little kid, you couldn't wait till you got a chance to order off the grown folk menu, amen. Give me that kid a menu, I'm grown now, I need some meat, grown up menu. They, you know, four times for the same meal, amen. But now I'm eating off the grown up menu. Paul said, here's the problem, church. When we ought to be able to be skilled in God's word, and eat the meat of the word, and go strong, and be able to bear heavy burdens and help others, we are babies ourselves. And Paul says to the church, needing ourselves to be nursed on milk and carried by others. Listen, don't ever get age in the church or time on station in the church, amen. Or time as a member in the church, don't start thinking of somebody that's having seniority in the church. Mm-hmm. We need to look at the spiritual development. Mm-hmm. For somebody to be in the Lord's church 56 years, like Brother Hub, and still be walking by their car and got a big old bottle, I need a bottle. They right there choking on meat. But they need a bottle. They need some simple back. They need some whatever simple back or whatever, high in the middle or something. Been in the church 80 years and still walk around. So don't get somebody's age and time on station. Or what we sometimes say is seniority, amen. Ain't no seniority in the church. Not age-wise. You start talking about seniority in the church, you talk about spiritual things. Mm-hmm. And there are some people in the church who haven't been in the church very long who are way more spiritual. Others who have been in it for years and years and years. And that's what Paul says. How can you help somebody else to bear a heavy burden when you are still a baby yourself? You don't see no baby walking around, sitting down in the chair, talking about counseling no adult. Sitting up in their high chair, something on a bottle. Somebody says, well, what's your problem? Really? Wow. How do you Hold up. Excuse me, I gotta go potty. You don't see no baby sitting across the table trying to counsel nobody. Amen. You have to be spiritually mature to be able to help somebody else in the body. And Paul said, and I'm not talking about next week, y'all. Y'all know I'm not talking about next week. Okay. I'm talking about the church. So Paul says to the church, you need to be nursed on milk and carried by others. Mm-hmm. I'm a spiritual sister in the church, and that young married sister comes to me and she's having marital problems. Ain't nobody talking about girl, I can use the number for a good divorce. If I'm a spiritual mature brother in the church, and that young brother comes to me is concerned about his marriage, and maybe he said his wife is not as submissive as he thinks she ought to be, I'm not going to be like the teachers in the Quran and say, tap them lightly. I want to go to God's word and make sure that, first of all, he's doing, amen, what he ought to be doing. If I am spiritually mature, I can't help you if I'm not spiritually mature. And just because I look like I'm spiritually mature don't mean always that I'm spiritually mature. Mm-hmm. You gotta listen. You gotta hear what people say, how they are talking. It'll be a better indicator of where they are spiritually. If they're saying, thus saith the Lord, versus thus saith Oprah Winfrey. When somebody talks to you and you talk to them about a problem, they try, thus saith Oprah Winfrey, amen. Or thus saith Dr. Phil, or all the other things that be on in the daytime. I don't watch it, I get work. Amen. Gotta be spiritual in order to help someone else. So that's what Paul was saying to the church of Corinth. And then Paul said that their state of spiritual immaturity was, he says it was evident. And he addressed some things of why there's strife and why there's envying and all these things among you. And if stuff like that is going on among us, then that means that we are not what we need to be spiritual. And I don't care who you are. Yes. Paul says it's evidence that you're not where you need to be spiritual because you have envying, you have strife, you have all these things going on amongst you. And Paul reminds us in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19, he says, these are works of the flesh. We talked about these on Friday night, Sam. Works of the flesh. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, and violence. He says, and such like. He says, I told you before, and I'm telling you now. Mm-hmm. If you do these things, yeah. Paul says to the church, you shall not inherit the kingdom of God. What are we trying to do? We're trying to go to hell. So we're not trying to take on more stuff that's going to keep us from going to heaven. If I'm climbing a mountain, well, it's just angel, it's good though. If I'm climbing a mountain, and every step I take up that mountain, I reach down and pick up another rock and put it in my pocket. And then I take another step and I reach down, pick up another rock and put it in my pocket. I say my goal is to climb the top of that mountain. I'm going to have a hard problem getting to the top of that mountain. But sometimes we say we are climbing to heaven, and every step we take, every move we make, we reach it down, picking up some more. Oh, Lord, help us. Then we wonder why we on the side of the mountain. Well, it's hard. Yeah, it's hard because we're trying to take all this junk with us.
Amen.
We're trying to take all this junk with us. You're not going to go to heaven with dealing with these things, things that Paul called the fruit of the Spirit, the works of the flesh. You're not going to be able to go to heaven with these things manifest, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, idolatry, witchcraft, envy, murder, all those things, because the Bible says they shall not inherit, or you shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So we gotta leave that stuff
behind.
Don't go out of our way to make somebody's life miserable, man. People are dealing with enough. I try my best to not make anybody's life more miserable than I know it already is. I'm of a mind, it took me a while to get there. I'm of a mind, if I can't do you some good, I'm so not going to do anything to hurt you. Not tell people, I'm not going to tell you to do anything wrong. That's not helping you.
Mm-mm.
I can't help you, I'm sure not going to hurt you.
Amen.
That's what you should be smarter with, man.
As we go.
Especially when you don't got that much.
Paul says we have to go, you have to pass all these things. True. He says you're dealing with all these things, you're dealing with the lust of the flesh and all these things. The works of the flesh, he said, you're not going to have your own.
Amen.
And then Paul tells him as I close him. He says, don't y'all be divided into factions or groups. He said, you have to recognize that we are all fellow workers. We are God's husbandry. We are all responsible for cultivating and nourishing God's church. All of us. As Christians, we have a responsibility to help the church to grow.
Amen.
I'm talking about spiritually, numerically, and every other kind of way that it needs to grow. We are all responsible. It's not just on one person. Grow to a point where you can be a benefit to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Women who have been married for many years, be at a point in your marriage, in your life spiritually, where you can counsel this young lady.
Right.
Brothers who have been in your marriage for many years, be at a point spiritually where you can counsel this person. Whatever way you can counsel a person, help a person, we need to be there spiritually because we don't know when somebody is going to come to us.
Amen.
And when somebody comes to us for spiritual counseling, and we profess that we are full-grown Christians, and we are students of the Word of God, and we are faithful to the Lord. When somebody comes to me for spiritual counseling, Lord, help me if I start to sound like Elmer Fudd. No, I should be able to help somebody to grow.
Mm-hmm.
To deal with whatever they're dealing with. I should be able to point them in the right direction based on God's word and say, this is what God's word says about that problem. Now, here's how you can fix it if that's your decision.
Mm-hmm.
Because some people not want to take your advice, amen.
Amen.
Unfortunately, some people don't want to see what you know. But you show them what you know based on God's word. And then it's up to that individual to accept it or to step back from it.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't follow what you give them straight from God's word, then they really may not be that concerned about it.
Mm-hmm.
Or at that point, they're just not that concerned about it. But we have to be where we are, and that's what Paul said to the church at Corinth. You have a responsibility to understand that you are fellow laborers. You're not against each other. You're all working together in the church to do what? To take care of the church. Because without the church, the world's in even greater trouble. Jesus sends his message through the church. And if the church can't help, then Lord help us all. When we are spiritual mature, we understand and we recognize, and it's evident to us, that the church was built by Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And like Paul reminded the church at Corinth, we are simply building on the foundation that Christ has already laid. Understand this. As a mature Christian, it's important that I understand that Christ laid the foundation. The church was built by Christ. Anything that we do to try to change the plan, the intent of the church is going to fall. If we try to change the material that is to be taught, it's going to fail. If we try to change anything about it, the location or anything about what Christ built, it's not going to work. Only through God can there be increase. So what Christ is built on, that's all we can build on. Sometimes we allow our own personal feelings and emotions to try to trump what the Word of God says. We can't do that. We have to stay with the Word of God. Paul said to the church of Corinth, here are the things you're dealing with. I know you can be better. I know you can do better. I know it's in you. And let me just remind this closer. Paul was so disappointed because in his mind, this was one of the strongest conversations that he had helped to plant. And if you ever spend any amount of time working with someone one-on-one, trying to bring them along and to nourish them, to help them to see what is good and precious and right before the Lord, and you have all this confidence that this person, they got it, they get it. They understand. We're trying to go to heaven. This is what it's going to take to go to heaven. We have to fear God and keep his commandments. And then it comes to your attention that they're not anywhere near where you believe they could be, should be, or ought to be. Get frustrated. That's what Paul was dealing with. And there are some things that Paul dealt with at Church of Corinth. We haven't gotten to some of those things yet. Some of those things were so mind-boggling that Paul says, you're doing things that even the Gentiles, they don't even have amongst them in their circle. And here you are saying you're the church. And you're doing these things. Paul said, you're doing things in the church that calls us to say, why would I want to be a part of that? I'm saying, oh, how I love Jesus and all these things. But I'm doing things that's not even so much heard of among the Gentiles. And what Paul said, he was kind of saying that, you can expect that, everybody probably will smile in their life and you hear somebody you like, right? That's what Paul said about the Gentiles. Ain't surprised by nothing I hear about them, but you guys have actually moved that out the way. Paul said, you're doing something that's not even so much as heard of among them. And Paul said, and while you're doing these things, you are not mature. You're not where you need to be. What does Paul want for the church of Corinth? Paul wants the church to be mature. Why does he want them to be mature? That's what Paul's going around and say, hey, look how mature they are. Hey, check them out. They mature, man, I tell you. They are so mature, man, how mature they are. Church of Corinth, oh, I think about the Church of Corinth, I think about maturity. They're just so mature. Paul's not doing that for that reason. Paul wants them to go to heaven. Man. I want people to just say, Main Street is so mature. I want Main Street to go to heaven. I want Nate Street to hear him saying, well done, Nate Street. Well done, I good and faithful servant. Let's see in. Amen. To the joys I prepared for you from the foundation of the world. That's what I want to hear the Lord say. It's not about some spike and pass on the back and say, boy, they are mature. They try to get a home up there. They just, that could all be just a show. So what's really it's in here. Right. How we treat one another.
That's right.
Because nobody else around. That tells us where we are spiritually. How we conduct our lives when no one else is around. That tells us where we are spiritually. It's all sinful to judge the Christ. That's what things we've done in this life are good or evil. There's no secret place that God cannot see. Amen. God sees your mind just as clear as I'm looking at this paper when I put my glasses on. He sees it just that clear. He's reading everything that's going on in your thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so glad I don't have that ability. And I'm even more glad that you don't have that ability. But God sees our heart.
Amen.
And all Paul is asking of the church of Corinth, he said, I know it's in you to be past where you are. Let's get there together. I'm saying to the church of nation, let's get that together. We have to take some serious in-depth look at ourselves. When we do wrong, we have to admit that we have done wrong. We can always do better. Because look at what we have at stake. What we stand to lose. It's not just a matter of losing. Okay, well, I'm not going to go to heaven. The heaven just crossed the street. Okay, well, I didn't make it to heaven. It's just across the street anyway. I could be okay with that. But we're not talking about just going across the street. We're talking about going to heaven. Amen. This is where God is. This is where Jesus is. Where the street is paved with gold, where the walls are jasper, a pearly gate. There'll be no more crying now. Somebody's tired of crying. Somebody's tired of getting calls about your lost another loved one. Somebody tired of the aches and pains that are going on in your body? Is somebody tired of tears of sorrow and all these things?
Mm-hmm.
And hurt? Is somebody tired of all that stuff?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not talking about just going across the street and maybe missing out on that. We're talking about missing out on maybe going to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to miss out on that. I don't want you to miss out on that. And I want to make sure that you're where you need to be. First of all, you need to become a child of God. Because if you're not a child of God, you're not a member of the Church of Christ, the blood-bought Church of Christ, you're not where you need to be today. You are nowhere close to where you need to be if you're not a member of the blood-bought Church of Christ. Jesus paid the ultimate price. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 lays out the facts of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He died on that cross for you and me. He was buried for you and me. He died on the third day for you and me. He told his disciples to go to all the world and tell his good news. Why is this good news to us? Why is all the things that he went through good news to us? Because that's what's going to save us by being obedient to that story, to the gospel of Jesus Christ, recognizing the facts of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. You have to hear that story.
Yeah.
And be willing to believe it. Without faith, it is impossible. Hebrews 11, 6. Please, him. You have to be willing to believe it, be willing to confess that he is the Son of God. And be willing to repent. That's a change of mind. To stop the way you're headed and turn and go towards God. Draw nigh to God. He will draw nigh to you. See, God never moves. God is always God. It's God. He's what he is. But the closer we move to God, the closer God is to us. The closer we get to him, the closer he is to us. It's incumbent upon us to move to him. So if you're doing things that are contrary to God's teachings and his word, I'm like this. If you're not willing to stand before the church and do them on sale, and they just tell us, you're not willing to do a sale in front of your mom. I don't need to be doing it. Or saved. We have to change. Repent. We have to change. We have to turn away from the world and turn towards God. And then we have to be willing to confess that I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That confession brought death to Christ will bring eternal life to you. Once you make that confession, go to the water baby baptism. The sins are washed away, see the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit, rise from all people's life, and add to the body of Christ, the Church of Christ. It's his bride, it's his wife, he's coming back for her. None of them. We have to be what we have to be, amen. He's coming back. And we have to live faithful unto death. We can't just become a child of God and just go back out in the world and do all the same things. We have to be faithful unto death. We have to live faithful unto death. He's out of your crown of life. If you're this one, you're not a child of God. The invitation is yours. I'd say another word. If you're just wanting to try to not fall by the wayside, whatever reason, you've done something to offend, or stepped outside of your bounds that you should step outside of, you get away this morning. Get away. God knows exactly what each of us do. The bishop don't have that ability to know. But I do know this. All have sinned, all short of the glory of God. And we all need the blood.